People have been living in cities for a very long time, and there has been urban poverty and exclusion for as long as there have been cities. And wherever there has been urban poverty, there have been slums. But as far as slums, poverty and exclusion is concerned, the most dramatic has come during our lifetimes. Now, at the end of the first decade of the 21st century, many cities in the south are doubling in population size every 15 years. And most of this growth takes place in the urban slums, the neighborhoods of the poor. Wherever poverty is urbanized, resistance and rebellion have been quick to follow. Nowadays, these take many different forms. They take the form of service protests, especially the right of access to land, water, sanitation, energy, or shelter. They take the form of demonstrations, marches, pickets. Again, statements of protest against government agencies that tend to maintain the social differences within urban societies. Or they take the form of litigation, appeals to the courts to defend the poor or the marginalized in their lopsided struggles against the obstruction of their right to the city. As cities grow, these confrontations escalate, for the rhetoric of inclusion seldom translates into better life for all of city's residents. Ever-increasing numbers of families face regular threats of eviction or live in the margins of our cities, far from employment opportunities and basic amenities. More and more people live without access to water, sanitation, or energy. In spite of sporadic triumphs for those fighting for inclusion, retreats continue to outstrip advances. How then can organized communities begin to turn the tide? How can they take meaningful contributions to the struggle for inclusive cities? Over the past 15 years, an international network has emerged that has found ways to link the pragmatic survival strategies of the poor to rights-based struggles for inclusive cities. In other words, cities in which poor people do not only get to vote once every 4 years, but also get to participate in the development of their own residential areas. This movement is Slum Dwellers International. It originated on the pavements of Mumbai, but now, in 2010, it has affiliates in hundreds of cities in 33 countries in the south. The significance of the approach to inclusive cities used by the SDI affiliates is that they have knitted together different strategies that are normally separated into different spheres and different specializations. As a result, slum dwellers are not only passive beneficiaries who wait for or demand the delivery of entitlements from outsiders, particularly governments. While most community organizations are encouraged to name and shame offending or recalcitrant governments as a means of securing their rights, SDI's federations of the urban poor engage governments around developmental challenges and solutions. The logic is simple. If we want sustainable, people-centered development and inclusive cities, we have no choice but to engage very seriously both in reforming our existing institutions and building new ones. Demanding solutions from them, blaming them for failure, or waiting for them to deliver simply will not work. But in order to try and change these institutions through engagement, communities need to develop citywide and even international solidarities, and at the same time be organized around their own resources and capacities. Powerful tools such as daily savings, the mobilization of women, community self-surveying and mapping have been used consistently by SDI affiliates. These tools enable meaningful change in the lives of tens of thousands of marginalized and formerly excluded citizens. From the pavement dwellers of Mumbai to the rag pickers of Manila, from the backyarders of Cape Town to the tenants of Nairobi. By following these basic steps, the affiliates of Slum Dwellers International have been able to challenge existing inequalities through sustained critical engagement. And they have done so in a way that has kept the initiative in the hands of the people. Cities will be much more a part of our collective future than they are at present. Whether they are inclusive or continue to be as exclusionary as they are now depends on many complex factors. But the most important by far will be the capacity of slum dwellers, in particular women, and especially those who are poor and marginalized, to unite and come together in local, national, and international networks. To build assets, accumulate local knowledge and set priorities, and engage other stakeholders, especially the state, in order to broker deals. Networks like Slum Dwellers International may not yet present solutions to the struggle for inclusive cities, but they certainly are pointing the way for this elusive goal to be achieved.